Good morning. Thank you so very much for joining us today. We are an Outside of the Box Children Parenting Series where we explore various topics for children with special needs, challenges, quirky issues, all kinds of wonderful things as we go through the parenting journey together. And so we are delighted to have you all join us today. We are going to be discussing dyslexia policy and some significant changes in Texas policy. And we're getting an update on that today from Robbi Cooper, our wonderful, amazing advocate and friend at Decoding Dyslexia Texas, which is a grassroots movement committed to helping parents, students, educators, and policymakers make informed and evidence-based decisions about dyslexia, which is an unexpected difficulty in learning to read. So we have had a lot happen here in Texas that will affect all of our children. And so we are excited to hear from Robbi and see what we think is going to be in store for us as we go forward. Robbi will be available as well for after the meeting questions. And so if anyone has any questions that they would like to discuss more privately, she's available. Robbi, do you want to take questions during it if anyone has a clarification, or would you rather that they hold their questions to the end?
I prefer it the end so I can get through the slides.
Right.
I'll try to make it quick.
Okay, no problem. We are thrilled here today. And we want to thank West Bank Library, as always, for doing such an exceptional job in helping us with getting the message out and exploring these topics. So thank you again to West Bank Library. And without further ado, we will turn it over to Robbi Cooper to talk about dyslexia policy changes in Texas. Thank you, Robbi.
Thank you, Becky. This is really an important time to talk about dyslexia policy changes in Texas, and I'm really grateful to have the opportunity to do so. I want to get started here, so we can just start with my first slide. We'll just roll through now. So this is dyslexia policy changes. I'll go over the agenda, basically what I want to go over today. I always like to start with what is dyslexia. I'm going to keep it really short because you can find that information from other sources. The history of why we have the changes is really kind of important to understand. I'll touch on that, but the main part of my presentation is going to be going over the major policy changes in Texas affecting dyslexia policy and the students and parents. And then I will touch on a little bit what parents should expect now and resources and how to find help. So next slide. Okay, so what is dyslexia and when is the best time to intervene? We'll go to the next slide. So dyslexia is a specific learning disability. It's neurological in origin, and it's characterized by difficulties with accurate and or fluent word recognition and by poor spelling and decoding abilities. These difficulties typically result from a deficit in the phonological component of language that is often unexpected in relation to other cognitive abilities and the provision of effective classroom instruction. Secondary consequences may include problems in reading comprehension, reduced reading experience that can impede growth of vocabulary and background knowledge. This is the basic definition that the board of directors for the International Dyslexia Association approved, and it's still used today by the National Institute of Health and Human Services. So basically, IDEA has always included dyslexia. I really want to stress this because I've seen the presentations recently even that have stated that dyslexia was just recently included under IDEA, and that is absolutely false. It has been in the IDEA statute since 1978. So you've always had a right to an IEP for dyslexia. So we'll go to the next slide. So what should you be looking for when you suspect dyslexia? I have a little graphic on the right or on the left-hand side, that kind of goes through some of the indicators for dyslexia. This graphic is available, and I'm happy to share it with you after the presentation, but I just want you to know there are warning signs and indicators for that. And the most effective time to intervene for dyslexia is K through second grade. And so Texas does require screening for at-risk in kindergarten and second grade. It's because it's not a good idea to wait and see if your child's struggling to read. So we always suggest that you make a request for writing for a full and individual evaluation to determine why your child is not keeping up with their peers when they're learning to read. And so we can go to the next slide. And this is based on the dyslexia paradox, or the wait to fail approach. And this is sort of a documented by research, you can see cited, that the most effective time to intervene for dyslexia when these interventions are easiest to work with children's developing brains is pre-K through middle of first grade. And so we wanna make sure that we do not wait and we screen and we intervene, because currently many times schools across the nation, and not just in Texas, will wait until students are falling further behind in second grade, third grade, and fourth grade before they decide that they want to evaluate and diagnose and give intensive interventions. And this just wastes the time of the child, and the frustration levels can go up, as well as it's less effective to start at that time. You could start earlier and have greater gains. So we'll go to the next slide. Okay, so I want to go over a short history on why we have policy changing in Texas. Okay, so there's been a significant amount of federal oversight in Texas for the past 5 years. Texas has been had been found in violation of IDEA law, and much of the violations concern Texas's dyslexia policy. There has been a misuse and overuse of 504 plans. And there's lots of documentation if people want to read about it. I'm happy to share letters back and forth from the Department of Education to the Texas Education Agency on this issue. So we'll go to the next slide. So just basically understanding the events that led to the policy changes that we're experiencing now in Texas. Started in 2015, probably prior to that, but on a national level, the U.S. Department of Education was hearing not only from Texas families, but many families across the United States, that schools were reluctant or refusing to put dyslexia into IEP documents. Using the term seemed to be taboo. And so the U.S. Department of Education came out with a guidance letter to all states that it's okay to use the term dyslexia in an IEP, and actually you should be doing so when appropriate. And so in 2016 and 17, the Houston Chronicle did a series called Denied. It hit the media, exposing a cap that Texas had placed on special education. And so what happened because of the cap is that schools were being penalized for having what the state considered too many students in special education, receiving special education services. So they schools started figuring out ways to comply with the cap, and that meant, that kind of led to denying a lot of families access to their rights under the IDEA. And so that led to an investigation, and Texas was found in violation of their child fine duty. So in 2018, the first handbook was revised. It failed to fix the issues, unfortunately. There's ongoing reviews of other handbook revisions. I can skip the rest, but basically in 2000 and 2022, which is where we are now, we have a new handbook, and it is very clear that the process must start under Child Find through a full and individual evaluation under the IDEA. And I'll go to the next slide to kind of show you how many handbooks. There have been 9 handbooks issued. And while many of the contents in all of the versions evolved through the years and continue to do a very good job of describing what types of interventions are best appropriate for students with dyslexia, they started getting a little fuzzy through the years on infringing on parent rights. And the last little graphic, you know, I tried to make a little bit light because, you know, we always hear, you know, dyslexia is a superpower and, you know, all these things. And there's all this controversy around whether or not it's a gift or not a gift or a superpower or not. But what I will say is I want to make the point that the Texas Dyslexia Handbook has changed, and it is about you're reclaiming your parent power, okay? So it's really important to get to know the new handbook and really rethink where your parent voice is in the IEP process. So we can skip to the next slide. So I guess we would say, what went wrong, you know, through 9 handbooks, you know, what is the main problem? What went wrong? Well, there was an overuse or misuse of 504 plans for dyslexia, okay? Kind of a misrepresentation or misunderstanding about what IDEA is. And many parents were scared away from even going through the IDEA Child Find process. They were scared of special education. They didn't know what it meant. They were given all kinds of, you know, sort of innuendos sometimes when they were hearing about special education from schools, as if you don't want your child in special education. And so parents were sort of dangled the 504 plan. But what I want to make clear is we all need to start thinking a little differently about what special education really is. It is not a place and has never been a place. So your kid isn't put in special education. What special education provides, it gives you an IEP, which is an individual educational plan, which is legally binding and documents specifies what specially designed instruction and services, when, where, and for how long those services will take place. It includes measurable annual goals, progress monitoring to ensure your students' needs are met. And it is basically a legal document. You know, that is what special education ensures you as a parent, a document that spells out how your child's needs are going to be met. And they could be met in the general education setting, they could be met in a pullout setting, they could be met elsewhere. But it is not a place. You're not sent to a room unless you as the parent agree that that room or setting is the appropriate setting and you're okay with that. So it's funny that many 504 plans in Texas look strikingly similar to IEPs, but they don't carry the legal processes to ensure that what is written in those plans is happening. Your recourse for going wrong on a 504 plan, as great as it may look in writing, is the Office of Civil Rights. And that is, you know, they are not set up to handle disputes about, generally, about intervention programs. And if your child is making adequate progress, that is what special education plans are for. So IDEA and 504 really go hand in hand. They're both great federal laws. One is to ensure that your student has their educational needs being met as adequately as other students And the other one is spells out what those needs are and how they're going to be met and hold schools accountable to those. So we can go to the next slide. Okay, so Texas was found to be in violation of the IDEA child find mandate and has made some major changes, specifically regarding dyslexia, to ensure families' rights under the IDEA statute are protected. There are so many levels of changes that has happened. TEA has been working very hard on many, many of these critical issues, not just the handbook, but state regulations on specific learning disability, which is SLD, that's the acronym, had to be updated. They had to re-clarify in the SLD regulations, dyslexia and how it interacts. There were changes to the dyslexia handbook, which we'll go over in this presentation. They have done a lot of back and forth with OSEP, and they constantly are still going through back and forth with the Office of Special Education Programs, honing and fine tuning policy across the state. So we'll go to the next slide. And so, you know, the purpose that I really wanted to get to are, what are the major changes and what does it mean for parents? It should mean that parents reclaim their mandated seat at the table when discussing and creating plans that meet their students' needs. So we can go to the next slide. So what is happening now? So there's a new Texas Dyslexia Handbook, and it spells out the process and the process of getting identified for dyslexia starts under the IDEA. And this gives parents major rights they have been denied for decades. There's also presentations that the TEA is doing currently, reminding schools of the responsibilities to abide by the IDEA law. They've issued several to the administrator addressed letters, which are letters that are a little bit formal in nature that go out to you know, responsible parties in each district, basically telling them that, you know, certain things that they need to be doing or changing and making sure you know, that those things are happening. TEA has also created some professional development that schools must make assurances that they have sent somebody to, so that they understand what these changes are. And, you know, they're working incredibly hard. So one of the big things that just came out recently, we've been waiting, advocates have been waiting for a long time for this to finally be posted, but on March 18th of 2022, the FAQ document for the Texas Dyslexia Handbook was posted. And what the Q&A, it's called Appendix A, and it's questions and answers. And there's a little screenshot in the slide on the right-hand side. And you can pull that full document off the TEA Dyslexia website. And it just goes through basic questions and answers, and it really makes clear beyond a shadow of a doubt that dyslexia, when you suspect dyslexia, parents are to be offered a full evaluation under the IDEA. And it kind of spells out a lot of the kind of fuzzy areas that might inhibit schools from interpreting the actual handbook in a way that benefits parents. So, you know, it's a great step forward. The appendix questions and answers are a huge resource for families and educators in our state. And I really hope that y'all go to that website and really look at the handbook and really look at the questions and answers so you can fully understand what's going on. And in the meantime, the U.S. Department of Education is still reviewing Texas's submitted policy changes. So we're still under a corrective action. We haven't fulfilled everything yet. So we've come a long way, but I want parents to remember that, and I'm going to mention this website several times in this presentation because it's important, that the U.S. Department of Education has set up a website, Texas in TX Inquiry at ed.gov, because they want to hear from families if things are not going right. It's important to share any concerns that you may have with the U.S. Department of Education as they make sure that our state is really going through the appropriate changes to help families going forward. So we'll go to the next slide. So the new policy, and it's an there's new policy and there's a new Texas Dyslexia Handbook. These are just very simple major shifts in parent benefits. One, I've mentioned all dyslexia evaluations should now happen through IDEA, not Section 504. So if that's not happening, that's a red flag. You should let Department of Ed know. Number two, the IDEA process gives parents a full evaluation and the procedural safeguards that come along with that. And that is huge. Section 504 does not carry the same procedural safeguards for families. Another major thing in the policy changes is that dyslexia intervention should now be documented in an IEP. And this goes over in more depth in the FAQ document that I discussed in the last slide. The IEP is a binding document. And so schools can no longer start and stop dyslexia interventions at will with no consequences, like they sometimes do in a 504 plan. So you want to make sure that your interventions now are documented in an IEP. And also clarified in the Q&A and policy in Texas is that highly trained dyslexia interventionists, like therapists, can and should be working with students who have IEPs. They do not have to be special education teachers or certified to teach in special education. They simply must be that most highly trained teacher at your campus, and they can work with a kid in the IEP, okay? So there should not be any more excuses on why you can't have that in an IEP. And I want people to remember the little red bubble on the corner of the slide that all requests for testing, you should make those in writing. Okay, you just want to make it in writing. You shouldn't have to, but that is the best practice for parents. So we'll go to the next slide. And so this slide highlights a lot of the IDEA rights. And these are the rights that you will have when you start the evaluation process under the IDEA. And just remember this too, you know, if you start the IDEA process and the evaluation through IDEA, that doesn't mean you're agreeing to an IEP or an individual education plan for your student under special education. You can choose not to. Even if you do the full evaluation under IDEA, you can say, oh, great, thank you for the information. I don't really want my child to have an IEP. But we want to make sure in the rights that you have just by starting the process through IDEA, you should really understand. And I have some of them listed here. The rights that are triggered when you start your evaluation process through IDEA are substantial. And I guess I can read through them all. Let me see how much time. Okay, I'll go quickly. So you are a required member of the ARD team. So that's the Admission Review and Dismissal Committee in Texas. That is the team that will look at the evaluation under IDEA and make all decisions regarding the child. You are part of that team and you have to agree. Okay, not so under 504. Those 504 committees, while they do sometimes include the parent and many times they do, they're not required to. And so you, as an ARD committee member, make the decisions with the school. Okay, you have a right under IDEA to create an IEP, which will detail your child's present levels of academic performance. This is really important because you want to start the document of an IEP with where your child is currently. And then you're going to create from the current levels, you're going to create goals and progress monitoring to ensure that your child will be making progress. So this also includes the specially designed instruction, which the Department of Education has come back to Texas to let them know that dyslexia services spelled out in the dyslexia handbook are considered specially designed instruction when written into the IEP. So you should have dyslexia instruction written in there, how many minutes it's going to last for, how many days a week they're going to be providing your student that. They can also add other things that your child may need, like speech therapy, occupational therapy, but any of that, anything that's included, you must agree to. And once agreed upon, the school must follow the IEP plan. Okay, so your student under the IDEA also has special protections in disciplinary matters. And they also, another part of the IDEA that I particularly love, my son's in college now, so, but during his sort of middle school, high school time, was transition planning. It's mandated. Once your child is 14 or in the ninth grade or earlier if needed, the IEP must be tailored to help your child achieve his or her transition goals, including preparing for college or career. So there's a meeting that goes on at about the child's 14th year. Ours happened when he was transitioning to middle school, from middle school to high school. And he was asked, look, what do you want to do? Where do you want, you know, are you interested in college? Are you, you know, what are your interests? And he, you know, he was interested in the time in math and science. And so a lot of his IEP goals and, you know, supports were to make sure that those types of courses that would prepare him for his chosen career college path were in place. You know, it's important. Transition planning is important and it happens under IDEA. So remember that when you're preparing for college with your kid. You also get extended year services. If your child needs assistance during summer breaks, you could get dyslexia therapy over the summer if your child needs it. You know, there's a lot of different, you know, services or supports that if you think your child needs it over the summer, so they don't regress, you can ask the school for that. You can seek reimbursement for services that may the school district failed to provide. You could ask for tutoring, you know. You have a right to seek compensatory education for services that the school district may have failed to provide, which were written into your child's IEP. So unlike 504, where they might be able to start and stop the dyslexia class, which hopefully they don't, but you know, if they do, there isn't anything that's holding them accountable for compensatory education the way that the IDEA does. So they have to do what's in the IEP. And if they're not doing it, then you can seek compensatory educational services to make up for those missed IEP promises. And also, within the IDEA. It covers free assistive technology evaluations, free devices that your child may need, free training for your child and for the parent, and how to use those assistive technology devices that were deemed necessary. There's also free mediation and free ARD facilitation, and you have due process rights, which hopefully you won't have to exercise. But if you do need to, legally enforce some of the agreements in the IEP, it's very different than your rights under 504 if the 504 plan isn't being followed. So I'll go to the next slide. So what should parents expect going forward? And, I have so much hope for the future. So much has been done. It's a huge effort to get the changes that we have so far. And this is TEA's huge effort, the State Board of Education's effort. And I'm trying not to call people out because there are hundreds of people that have worked tremendously hard on changing the dyslexia handbook to help parents reclaim their rights. But I will say that without the help of Dr. Audrey Young, who is a State Board of Education member, and her leadership and tireless efforts to make sure that some of these changes happened, it is because of our elected officials and many times working with parents, listening to parents. It's a collective effort to make these changes. And I just want everyone to be aware that none of this is able to do on our own. So, I know that the people in Westlake that are listening, you do have a board member that is extremely supportive of parents and their rights and their students. Heather Sheffield is just outstanding. And so when I look at supporting changes, it's nice to have a team of people at every level that understand the issues and are willing to go to bat for families. And so, so anyways, we can go to the next slide. So what you should be expecting going forward is all testing requests for dyslexia should now be offered through the IDEA, and parents should be given your notice of IDEA procedural safeguards, which I listed some of the processes in the prior slides. Parents should be getting full initial evaluations under the IDEA. I will say dyslexia, like other disabilities, rarely exists on its own. And so many times it's so important to address dyslexia, but if you don't do a full and individual evaluation, it's hard to uncover any other issues that are maybe impacting your student. And so what happens with students with dyslexia is, even if we do get them into dyslexia, remediation, early on, and we're not aware of the full picture of their profile. They may still be struggling in other areas that might be impacting them in their dyslexia programming. You really need to understand the full picture of your child. Many have ADHD co-occurring. There's other language processing issues. Some students might have, other obvious issues like being blind or visually impaired. Those students can still have dyslexia. So the full evaluation really gives parents enough information to sit down with their school and make informed decisions about how best to help their child succeed. So this is what should be happening going forward. And we'll go to the next slide. But the school says dyslexia is 504. Well, if you hear this any longer, you need to report it to the email address that I mentioned earlier, txinquiry@ed.gov. Okay, the U.S. Department of Education replied to Texas that standard protocol dyslexia instruction, SPDI, is one choice of specialized instruction. And even if they say that dyslexia is a general education issue, if you have a disability, general education is part of the continuum of least restrictive environment choices in an IEP, okay? So remember, dyslexia has been included under the IDEA law since 1978. And eligibility for IDEA for an IEP is a qualifying disability, which dyslexia is one, plus a need for specialized instruction. That triggers IDEA eligibility. So if you hear the school say that we do dyslexia under 504 or it's a general ed issue, you don't need an IEP. You just need to be confident enough to say, hey, wait a minute, I don't agree with that. Put that in writing and really stand your ground. Okay, so we'll go to the next slide. You need to remember that the IEP gives parents power that you will not have under 504 alone, okay? I say alone under 504 because 504 really is part of, if you have an IEP, you are protected under section 504, okay? So you have both. IDEA and 504 do walk hand in hand many times, but the 504 alone will not give you the same rights as a parent that or a student that you would have if you had an IEP. So we'll go to the next slide. You can get an IEP after a special education evaluation under IDEA, okay? So you get, you have your IDEA evaluation, your full and individual evaluation. And remember, special education is not a place. It generates a document called an IEP, which is an individualized intervention plan, that legally binds the school to provide what is contained within it, okay? So you can get an IEP after you have your full evaluation under the IDEA. And we'll go to the next slide. And if there's any doubt, standard protocol dyslexia instruction is one choice parents can choose to include in the IEP. And when it's written into the IEP, the standard protocol dyslexia instruction can't start and stop without your agreement, okay? I can't tell you how many times I hear this, and I hope you're not one of the parents on this call that experiences this, that they have, their child is currently in a dyslexia program at the school. They don't have an IEP for it. And it's sometimes they just find out that it just stopped for a couple of weeks or something else happened and it's not happening the way that they were told to fidelity, you know, with the program 4 days a week, 45 minutes a day or whatever it is. If you don't have it written into an IEP, you're gonna have a really hard time holding the school accountable to it. Okay, when they don't want to do it or they, quote, can't do it or whatever the reasoning is, unless it's in an IEP, it's not necessarily an easy way to bind them to doing it. And you really need to make sure that you can make sure your kid's getting what they need as early as possible and for however long they need to have it. So we'll go to the next slide. And so, you know, pow. The need for dyslexia interventions should trigger your right to an IEP, period. If you need the dyslexia intervention. If you need specialized instruction and your student has dyslexia, which is a qualifying disability under the IDEA, that should trigger your right to an IEP. And you should feel very comfortable with that knowledge and making sure that if you want that IEP to list dyslexia instruction, you should be able to go into your meetings and stand your ground. And so we'll get to the next slide. So there's a few resources that I want to point parents to make sure they can find help with all this. The first is the TEA, which is the Texas Education Agency, dyslexia webpage. And you can just Google it. So TEA, dyslexia, and you'll come up, their webpage will come up. And they have a link on that webpage to the Texas Dyslexia Handbook, the 2021 version, which is the most recent version. It's a black cover. And it also has a link to the accompanying FAQ or Appendix A, which spells out, I think there's 40 something questions and answers that will answer many of your questions. And enough questions answered there that you can go to your school. If they're telling you one thing, it doesn't seem right. And you probably have the answer right there. And you can just say, well, the Appendix A, the FAQ for the handbook, which is state policy, says this on answer number 10. It's a huge resource. I think every parent needs to read it, the new handbook, and read the accompanying questions and answers. It's a huge help. So also parents can reach out to spedtex.org. It is a TEA funded support call center for parents. And I have high hopes that they will be giving parents good information. So that is spedtex.org. You can also reach out to the Partners Resource Network. That is a federally funded parent outreach organization. They do webinars and other trainings on special education for families in our state. And we enjoy them, and we want to make sure that you're aware of them as a resource. And, you know, with any of these, if parents encounter any problems, you should be sharing those concerns with the Office of Special Education Programs at txinquiry@ed.gov, because they want to know. They want Texas to change. In Texas, the TEA, I feel like they want to change as well. So it's a huge state. And so we need to let OSEP know when things are not happening, and they will work together and support those changes with the TEA. And having more eyes on your issue is better for your kid. So we'll go to the next slide. And some other parent-focused resources that are important or helpful. The one that's really great right now is that was just announced recently that the annual International Dyslexia Association National Conference is going to be held in San Antonio this year. And so November 10th through 12th, you will have access to top researchers in the country, people that live dyslexia 24/7, We'll all flock to San Antonio. And parents, if you want to learn more about how to help your child, if you want to learn more about dyslexia, this is a place to go, and it just happens to be in our state. So, I mean, that's a big deal, and I'm going to go. I always learn. But some other resources from TEA. They have put out, you can Google this too, just say, Google TEA dyslexia in the IEP, okay? And so TEA's come out with a document that shows you how to write goals, you know, what should be included in the IEP for dyslexia. And it really does a really good job walking the parent and the school through that. So, you know, you can go there. I have the link, but you can just Google, you know, the terms, and it'll bring up this PDF file. I highly encourage every parent to print it, and or at least have it on hand, and take those to your meetings, and, you know, make sure that your IEP document is written in a way that's helpful for your kid. Okay, so there's a whole nother presentation on how to write goals and objectives, and that's probably best done by people like Kelly Sandman Hurley, and she's one of my resources here, but her book, The Dyslexia Advocate, really focuses in on, you know, making sure that the IEP plan is written appropriately. And so I encourage people to look for that book and get it if you can. So there's also understood.org if you're not aware of them. They are very parent friendly. They do a lot of very simplified overviews of you know, dyslexia and other specific learning disabilities and your rights, and they have experts kind of chime in, and it's a really great resource. Bookshare.org and Learning Ally are two amazing audiobook providers. And they just, you know, our kids need to be able to read. And so read a lot. And many times, even after appropriate interventions, they can read, but they're not able to read as fast. And school starts sort of, you know, collapsing in on them, and they can't keep up many times. And so audiobooks allow our children at various stages to have access to content that they would not normally have either the time or ability to access. So those two are important for our kids. And madebydyslexia.org just does a tremendous amount of work in the space, everywhere from early indicators of dyslexia. They have a partnership with Microsoft and Microsoft tools and how to use all these great AT assistive technology tools built into devices. It's just a great hopping in point for a more broader look at dyslexia. Then, you know, we also have the Dyslexia Training Institute, which trains teachers, but it also does a lot of good parent training, and it's a great resource. Of course, Decoding Dyslexia Texas, I have to plug our organization as well. I love the Empower Dyslexia podcast. Stephen Urat is the man behind it, and he's just amazing. And so tune in, listen to him. You know, he covers all kinds of topics related to dyslexia. He's dyslexic himself, and it's just a powerful, very, very good use of time to listen in. Another book, Overcoming Dyslexia by Dr. Sally Shaywitz, is you know, a classic. And so if you don't have that already, check it out in your library, or you know, find it online. So, and we'll go to the next page. So, you know, we're gonna end by, let's talk about parent power of an IEP, okay? You're never gonna hear a lot of this from the school. You might have never known any of this stuff, but, you know, I hope the little graphic's a little light, changes the tone of my presentation a little bit. I'm not trying to make light of anything, but, you know, as we know, it's hard parenting a child with disability, and it's incredibly difficult when there's so much resistance, with your school sometimes in providing appropriate services. So I hope things change going forward. I know hearts have changed on many levels. I know that there are a lot of people working behind the scenes that have wanted these changes that just didn't have the backup to get it done. So we can talk more about the power of an IEP. And so we did put together on the next slide a little roadmap a dyslexia roadmap. And I've had this, I think I did this, I don't know, several years ago, but it is, you know, it does, it tells you what you're going to have available to you if you're following the IDEA. And it's significant, specific rights under IDEA. And I didn't touch on this, but the first one I have listed on the second page of this document is, you know, the right to an outside evaluation if you disagree with the school's evaluation. Okay, they have to pay for you to get an outside evaluation. There are timelines for evaluations under IDEA that are not part of 504. Now, if schools aren't doing any of these, okay, so just because it's policy or law doesn't mean that it's always followed, right? So we'll go to the next slide. Remember to share your IDEA or 504 problems with OSEP. Okay, this is really critical. The U.S. Department of Education wants to hear from Texas parents about their struggles to get help for their children. Okay, they created a dedicated email address just for Texas. And I will say that I posted, you know, this on to my national group, which we have chapters in every state. And oh my God, every single state was like, how come we don't have our own dedicated email address from the Department of Ed? It is a huge deal. They don't make email addresses for, you know, every state. We have one. Okay. So, you know, if any of the rights that you've seen in this presentation, or when you look through the Texas Dyslexia Handbook, when you learn more about your rights, your procedural safeguards and rights under IDEA, when those aren't happening, okay, you need to let people know, because right now there are substantial changes happening in our state. And for whatever reason, whether it's, you know, just people don't want to spend the time to do it, or the school district doesn't want to do it, or they don't understand what the changes are. Right now we have oversight and help from so many organizations and entities kind of, you know, focusing in on Texas to help dyslexic families, you know, regain their rights under the IDEA and how to use them effectively, that it's not always going to be this way. So I'm always here to help. There's one resource I didn't put in the presentation you really need to be aware of, which is COPA, the Council of Parent Advocates and Attorneys, COPAA.org. They are attorneys and advocates. Many are trained. I mean, most are trained. I think there's some threshold there that needs to be met. I mean, these people are here to help you get through the issues if you experience anything. So reach out to COPA. If COPA members, they can find someone in your area that's COPA trained, if you run into any problems. And we're always happy to help guide you as well. So I think my next slide is my sort of cutoff and who I am. I'm, you know, I've been working on this issue for 10 years and I work, you know, to help families, districts in our state, you know, make better decisions and, you know, hopefully impact student outcomes. And I do like to travel in my van and kind of see the sights. And when I do, I try and incorporate awareness. Dyslexia is everywhere. So you can always reach me at the bottom of the slide. And any questions, I'm happy to answer now. Thank you for taking the time out of your day to listen in. And so I guess we can open it up for questions.
I do have a question about what happens after remediation with these changes. Could you talk a little bit about, and first of all, thank you so much, but I just want to be fast to give others a chance to ask, but what happens fourth grade, fifth grade after remediation? Schools keep saying passing grades is not proof of failure, and they are always wanting to cut back, deny accommodations, deny supports. They don't understand what modifications are, what they aren't. Even if we have an IEP for speech, they did not give us one for dyslexia, even after years of denial. So what happens, and I'm talking from Spring Branch in Houston. So what happens in moving into middle school after having had evaluation and coming up with a 3-year evaluation again, what happens then?
Okay, well, let me back up. I heard you say, I thought I heard you say something about at the beginning where you know, after the remediation. Okay, so remediation ends when your child no longer needs it, period, under an IEP. It doesn't end at a certain time if a program or whatever interventions have been offered to your student have been, you know, given. They don't graduate from a dyslexia program, which we hear a lot of. Under the IDEA, your goals and progress, your present levels of academic and functional performance should be brought to grade level. Okay, that's where we want them to be. And if they're not, the school needs to continue to provide a plan on how to meet your students' needs. So they shouldn't, under the IDEA process, your student receives what they need for as long as they need it. My child was covered with an IEP until he graduated and went off to college. So
are you saying being at grade level would be a reason to just cut back on services and just leave accommodations and for schools to just give a 504?
No, because I think it depends on what they're measuring. So grades alone don't determine, you know, your child's needs. I mean, there's one factor. I think you need to look at, I personally, the way that I look is, what are my child's goals? What are our goals for our family, for my student, you know? And then how do we get them there? Is just simply being, you know, I mean, you really need to look at the long term. I always look 5 years ahead when I'm looking at my child's progress, because we know as parents and educators that what's happening in fourth grade is very different than what's going to happen in middle school.
School districts think that the 2-year standard protocol of dyslexia is enough to just fulfill their minimum requirement of we gave this to your child. Now an accommodation of extra time or whatever is enough. No, it's crushing. It's terrible. So much needs to happen. So thank you so much for working on all those levels for it to trickle down.
Yeah. And if you do have anything like that, I always encourage that to be asked for in writing. And you need to send it off to the OSEP email address. And it's not going to get anyone in trouble, but what's going to do is going to alert them on how to help TEA help the districts to change and not say those things anymore, because they shouldn't be saying that to you. And they have been up until this point. It needs to change. You know, it's wrong. Thank you for tuning in.
Thank you so much.
Hi, I put this in the chat, but I'll go ahead and ask over the phone. If we had gotten tested only for dyslexia several years ago, and you're talking about, you know, recommending a full evaluation or maybe for looking for other issues like ADHD was the example you gave, what do we need to ask for? I feel like they're not going to necessarily volunteer that. Do we go back and ask them to go back and do a full evaluation? Do we need to give them a list of things to look for? What are our options there?
Yeah, I mean, I would say that, you know, you would like to request a full evaluation under the IDEA. And I would list all of your concerns. And that's what you're supposed to be doing when you're requesting one from the originally anyways, is you're listing all the concerns that you see as a parent. And I would add things in. And they need to come back. There is a Q&A in the FAQ document that I talked about that goes over that scenario.
Okay.
So now what we we pushed for and what we are continually advocating for with the TEA is that really it's a proactive responsibility of school districts to do the child find for, you know, they should be reaching out to any parent, in our opinion, that has a 504 plan for dyslexia interventions and saying, hey, you might be happy with what we have now, and that's fine, but you have a right to request a full evaluation under the IDEA, and here's how you do it, okay? But for right now, we're telling you to do it because it is your right, and TEA hasn't gone that far in rephrasing the answer to that particular question, but it is within those 40-something questions and answers to that you can request one.
Thank you.
I'm just going to interrupt now and let everyone know I'm going to end the recording unless you would like to proceed and have your questions recorded.
I know we have several questions in the chat. Does anyone want to ask their question explicitly now, or would they rather wait and we end the recording but continue the Zoom? If anyone feels like they need to ask the question that's being recorded, please do speak up now for a moment.
Is it possible to get a copy of your handout? It was an excellent presentation and handout, but I'm not sure I got everything in. Did you say that already?
Oh, yeah. You mean just the slides? Or
uh-huh. Yes.
Yeah, I'm happy to share the slides and also any of the, you know, links that are there and then some. You know, we'll try and find a way if people need any of those.
Robbi, would you like them to email you directly? I think that's what you did the last time, or should they email to the outside of the box? Sure. How would you like to?
Yeah, if they want to email me directly, that's fine. And if they email y'all have the PDF, right?
Yes, yes.
So, I mean, just share it and yes. Appear to share.
Yes. So, would you like to just read off your email address quickly?
Yeah, mine is ddtxinfo@gmail.com. So two D's and then TX.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Then we have one quick question. Where will the recording be posted? It is posted on the West Bank Library YouTube channel, generally within a couple of days of the presentation. So probably by tomorrow, maybe by Friday, depending upon exactly, you know, how the posting goes and all that. So just so that anyone wants to know, they can look at the West Bank Library YouTube channel. And that's where all of the previous presentations, including Robbie's equally fantastic presentation a few months ago, is posted up there as well.
Yeah, and I want to say, I really liked the first presentation. It dealt with the social emotional aspect of dyslexia.
Yes.
And it's really important. And I really thank you for letting me do that one, because we all know that what happens in an IEP and at the school is one thing, but the emotional toll that it takes on our kids is entirely another issue that we all have to deal with. So
yes,
Denise, you're outside thank of the box. Kids, it's just such a great venue. Thank you.
Thank you for and all of the support and information you provide. I know this is invaluable, so we cannot thank you enough, but we will stay on the Zoom and continue to answer questions unless anyone has any more last questions that they want included in the recording. We'll read off any of the questions that are in the chat, which I know there are quite a few. So please feel free to stay on for the continuation of questions, just not the recording.
So Stacy and Kay have their hands up.
I'm going to go ahead and end the recording so that any personal information won't be recorded. Okay.
Right.
And then we'll remain on Zoom.
Okay. Thank you.